Today a man is somewhere, proclaiming the good news, leading families to Jesus all around his neighborhood. He tells them that God is able to make their house a home. He wants to win his world for Christ, but he can't do it alone. But each one can reach one. As we follow after Christ, we all can lead one. We can lead one to the Savior. And together we can tell the world that Jesus is the way. If we each one reach one. The message is unchanging. Go ye into all the world and share the love of Jesus. Far away are door to door. For just like somebody told you that Jesus loves you so, you must tell someone who will tell someone till the whole world. One can reach one. As we follow after Christ, we all can lead one. We can lead one to the Savior. And together we can tell the world that Jesus is the way. If we're each one, reach one. So will you go and labor? Will you hold forth your lights? One by one and two by two, we can reach our world for Jesus Christ. We're each one, reach one, reach one. That's
what we like to do here at Grace Bible Church. Tell that old story. We do it in our worship services. We do it in our personal evangelism. And we do it in global missions. Because this is President's Day weekend, your missions conference planning committee thought it would be a good idea to bring a president to speak to you during the worship services this morning. Not a president of the United States, but a president of Arizona Christian University. And there he is, Dr. Len Munsil. Len has been the president of ACU now for 14 years, starting in 2010. Grace Bible Church has had a long history of relationship and partnership with Southwestern Bible College, now Arizona Christian University, going back not just years but decades. We have invested multiplied thousands of dollars in this fine work of God in Christian higher education, and it's a joy for us to bring Dr. Munsil to be the keynoter for this year's missions conference. Dr. Munsil has seen on his watch the Lord prosper that school immensely. They went from about 400 students when he took over to over 1,200 students right now. And Len and his dear wife, Tracy, are doing their best to expand the student body even more through their family planning. They have 8 children. And now 18 grandchildren, all of whom are under the age of 7. And so in time, thanks to the Munsil family alone, the school will have about 1,500 students in 2 years. Mark my word, I'm a prophet of the living God. And without any further ado, Dr. Len Munsil. Listen.
Well, thank you, Pastor Bill, and thank you for the opportunity to be here with you this morning. So here we are in 2024, and it seems like all of the news is bad all the time. That's really how it feels right now. Wars, rumors of wars, divisive politics, increasing violence and crime, hopelessness, addictions, and a steady decline in civility and kindness in our culture. So I'm here today to talk about hope for the future. But how can I do that when it seems like the news is bad, that all the news is bad all the time? Our verse for the missions conference is Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So Lord, help us to do that. Help us to have that hope. So as you begin your missions week, I know there's focus on missions throughout the world. And what I want to do this morning really, though, is focus on what's happening in our country, in the United States of America, because we play such a key role in funding and in sending missionaries into the world. At least we have historically. So what we want to do this morning is we want to go from talking about the great unraveling of our nation and culture to a place where we can have joy and peace and trust and overflowing hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And to do that this morning, we need to talk about generational change. We need to talk about returning this nation to the biblical foundations, the foundations that have blessed not only all of us, but many nations of the world. Way back on January 5th, 1967, Ronald Reagan was inaugurated as governor of California. And in his inaugural speech, he famously said, "Freedom is a fragile thing, and it's never more than one generation away from extinction." One generation away. And without question, what he said nearly 6 decades ago is true. And I think we're finally starting to realize it with the events of the past few years. The attacks on freedom of speech. In fact, I was a little nervous, Pastor, when you said we're going out live on YouTube, because I'm not sure if they're going to have like somebody there to cancel various parts of my, not sure what's left of my message after the censors get done with it. But we're seeing attacks on freedom of speech. We're seeing attacks on freedom of religion, attacks on Christianity. And it's becoming more commonplace in our culture. College campuses in our nation have largely become hotbeds of anti-American and anti-biblical ideologies, leading to these protests and violence. And these conflicts in our culture have been becoming more intense and more violent. A few months ago, I don't know if you saw this poll from the University of Virginia Center for Politics, which found that 41% of Biden voters and 38% of Trump voters agreed on something. They agreed that the other side was so dangerous that it would be okay to use violence to stop them from achieving power. Now think about that for a minute. Nearly half of our nation is ready to physically fight and be violent in order to stop the other side from achieving power. So it really does feel like we could be just one generation away from losing all of the things that we have become accustomed to in our nation. But what I want us, what I want to challenge us about this morning to think about is to think about the converse of that statement, that the converse is also true. In fact, I believe that depending on what we do at this moment in history, we are just one generation away from being able to place Christ back at the very center of culture and rebuilding the foundations that have been destroyed. And so that's why I want to talk to you about our nation's biblical foundations, how we got from there to where we are today, and how we can have hope for the future. And I'm deeply honored to be invited by grace to participate in this missions conference. I've just got to tell you, at Arizona Christian University, we're so grateful for your support, for the partnership that you've given us in ministry for many years. Such faithful support of what God is doing at ACU. And your pastor and I served on the board of trustees there many years ago, and he was part of the group that called me into the role of president of a Christian university. And he's taken another step today by offering me the pulpit, which is a dangerous thing to do. I didn't go to seminary. I went to law school, which is, if you think about it, kind of the opposite of seminary. And prior to that, I was a journalist. And, you know, Jesus said, "Woe to you scribes and lawyers." So it's a risky thing for him to put me up here. But, you know, I was involved for many years in as an attorney fighting for Christian values and for biblical values and religious liberty and the sanctity of life as the founder of the Center for Arizona Policy, and got involved in the political arena. You mentioned, you know, having a president here. And I was always told that you had to be governor before you could be president. But apparently that's not true, because what you see there is a picture of the highlight of my very brief political career. 18 years ago, the night that I won the Republican primary for governor of Arizona and became the only person to defeat a Goldwater in a statewide race in Arizona, the late, great Senator Barry Goldwater's nephew, Don Goldwater, was my primary opponent. And that night, I was a pretty big deal. It lasted about 5 minutes, if I remember correctly. But as timing goes, timing is everything in politics. I was happened to run in the year that was a great big national blue wave, and not a single Republican challenger defeated a Democratic incumbent. I was not the exception, but I had great timing to be an accidental college president. But I've learned, of the thousands of people I've talked to since that election who've told me how they voted, including a gentleman here at Grace yesterday, I'm winning like 99.8% of the vote of the people who told me how they voted. And so what I didn't realize at the time is that you could just declare that you actually won the election and it was stolen. And so I've decided to do that. I'm gonna jump on that bandwagon. I'm 18 years late, but based on my personal survey of voters, I think I won. The real story though, is you see our family, our kids then were between ages 8 and 19. I realized after I won the primary that there was no governor's mansion in Arizona. And at that point, we kind of lost our motivation and mailed it in. But what a great experience. What a great journey for my wife, Tracy, and me. And I want to introduce my wife. Dr. Tracy Munsil is over here. You just stand and say hi. We did do our part. We had 8 children in a little over 9 years. I say we. She did all the hard work, but she actually, true story, her doctor once asked her what was wrong with her husband. She kept coming back pregnant, and she said, "Well, obviously nothing." And we met at the student newspaper at Arizona State University, where she was my boss, and we decided to make it permanent. So we got married 37 years ago. She home educated our kids, and I was out running the Center for Arizona Policy, and I'd speak to groups, and I would say, you know, my wife is actually a lot smarter than me, and that's why she's home teaching the kids, and I'm out doing the work of running the Center for Arizona Policy. But and she had to go and prove it. And so after our kids all got launched, she went back and got her PhD at Arizona State University in political theory. As we say, she's theory and I'm practice. And so she's the true Dr. Munsil. I get introduced that way a lot. I've got a Juris Doctor. She's got a PhD. If you're sick, neither of us can help you at all. But couple of doctors. But so she's done a lot of things at ACU. She started our political science program. She oversaw the revamping of our core curriculum to a classics-based, humanities-based curriculum at the university. Now works with George Barna, the famed author and researcher who has come to be a part of ACU on research at the intersection of faith and culture. Well, after decades of work to influence public policy nationally and in Arizona on behalf of biblical principles, in 2010, I became, again, the interim president of what was then Southwestern College. And I committed 2 years to it, and that was 13 and a half years ago. And it's a college that had a really deep and rich history to of commitment to Scripture, commitment to God's Word. But like a lot of small colleges, was really struggling, and for many years struggling, can we make it, can we make it? I made the mistake as a board member of saying, you know, I think Phoenix needs a Bible-believing, conservative Christian college, and I think there will be support for that. And then about a year later, I was asked to step in as interim president. In the first year, we changed the name to Arizona Christian University. We invited President Bush to come and raise some money. We established a sort of a renewed commitment to biblical truth and to cultural engagement and bringing conservative principles into our culture. And with an expanded mission of preparing Christian leaders of influence and excellence to go into every area of our culture. As Pastor mentioned, at a time of shrinking college enrollment, we have tripled in size. And with George Barna's arrival 4 years ago, have become much more visible nationally, with students now coming from 40 states and 30 countries around the world. We had a complete miracle of God where we were able to trade a 20-acre landlocked campus that was really limiting our growth. And now we're on a 75-acre campus in Glendale, the former home of the Thunderbird School of Global Management. And so in one fell swoop, God gave us 3.5 times the space, the academic, the classrooms, the residence hall space, and facilities, 35,000 square foot library, a total miracle, because it was pretty much a straight up trade, except they gave us a little bit of money to help with the demolition of some old barracks. And so since we've moved there, God has continued to bless, and the enrollment has exploded. Each student at Arizona Christian University gets a minor in biblical studies. So the student that we graduated a few years ago who just finished at Harvard Law School at the top of his class has 18 hours of Bible and a biblical worldview. So we're sending students out into leadership in the culture in every area. And obviously, we still are preparing many pastors, many missionaries, many worship and music leaders. But at the same time, we're sending leaders into business. We're sending leaders into government. We're sending leaders into the medical field. We're sending leaders into education and into the media and into the arts with the idea that when you're a follower of Jesus, no matter what you do vocationally, you're in full-time ministry. That's our role as followers of Jesus. And really what we want to do is we want to prepare our students to be salt and light in their culture and to be a part and instigating the next great awakening. Now, to be admitted to ACU, you have to be a believing Christian. So our philosophy is that iron sharpens iron. There only a few Christian colleges hold to that standard for admissions. But we still do evangelism at our school. And I was sharing yesterday at the beginning of the missions conference how we use our recruiting weekends to share the gospel. And I actually got a text yesterday after I was done speaking, and that 16 souls came to faith in Christ yesterday, three entire families on our campus because of our outreach to the community. Last year, for the whole year, more than 400 Decisions for Christ happened on our campus. And it's the parents, the grandparents, the siblings, the boyfriends or girlfriends of students that we're recruiting that are coming to faith in Christ. And many of them will never be students at Arizona Christian University, but their lives are changed because they showed up on our campus to learn more about ACU and they heard the gospel and responded. So we're grateful for how God has used that at ACU. Well, what I've learned about education is that it's not just the supply lines. I talk about going from the front lines to the supply lines, but the reality is education right now is a battleground. It is the front lines of much of what is happening in our culture. So part of what we do at Arizona Christian University is to counteract a lot of the things that are happening in education generally and higher education in particular by teaching students about the biblical foundations of our nation. And so we teach them to effectively defend the values of Western civilization that flow from Scripture. Because most young people today that have been through our educational system have only heard and they've sort of been indoctrinated into what I would call the police blotter version of American history. It's like everything that we've ever done wrong is what they learn. The things that we've done well and the principles that we've upheld over centuries, the way that we liberate nations, we don't stay and conquer them. Things that no other nations do, they don't know that. All they know about is all the things, all the mistakes that we've made. And so is it any wonder if you're watching the news and you're seeing what's happening on college campuses and you have a terrorist group attack the nation of Israel and murder and kill people and take people captive, and you see a bunch of American college students protesting Israel, not the terrorism. And a lot of it, I'm not going to go into the detail this morning, but they've been sort of brainwashed into a approach to, it's called critical theory, and it's basically the notion that there's these oppressors and the oppressed, and that's all that matters, and Israel is an oppressor. So they can be attacked and treated brutally, and yet we're going to go protest them rather than those who perpetrated the violence. So we counteract that at Arizona Christian University. And so we're teaching our kids to understand our heritage, the good, the bad, and the ugly. We don't hide anything. But to understand that there's a reason why this nation has been blessed, we actually teach a course in American exceptionalism. With the idea that the nation has been exceptional, not because we're special people, but because our principles are founded on biblical truth. Any nation that will turn to God and turn to biblical truth and govern itself according to biblical truth can be exceptional. But America has done that historically. And so I feel like one of the reasons that what we're going through right now is so shocking to so many people is that because we all have lived in our lifetime with a level of freedom and prosperity and tranquility and opportunity that's uncommon in the history of the world. But there's a reason for that. There's a reason we've had such a stable and peaceful and prosperous period, why we've had such freedom. And it's related to our biblical foundations and the biblical worldview that undergirds our Constitution, our Declaration, and our nation's history. One of our founders said that America ultimately will either be governed by the policeman in our heart, and he was referring to the Holy Spirit, or the policeman on the street. So when you see what's happening in our country right now and in our culture, and you see the violence, and you see the lawlessness that is happening in many ways, it's because fewer and fewer people are guided by the Holy Spirit. And it has an effect on our nation. Without a commitment by our people to virtue, to right conduct, it's hard to maintain liberty. It's hard to maintain freedom. So the bigger the government becomes, the less freedom we have. As President John Adams famously said, our Constitution is made only for a moral and religious people, and it's wholly inadequate to the government of any other. And that's what we're discovering in our world today as we watch what's happening. Now, some have argued that the Constitution doesn't specifically reference God, and my response to that is it doesn't need to, because its very framework is based on scriptural principles. And deliberately, by design, the founders knew what they were doing. So if you read Isaiah 33, 22, it says, "For the Lord is our judge, the Lord is our lawgiver, the Lord is our king, he will save us." You don't have to look too hard to recognize the three branches of our government: judicial, legislative, executive, in that passage of Scripture. And the founding fathers knew that. They understood another thing, which is that man's nature is fallen. So if you don't believe that we're naturally prone to sin and need to guard against that in our own lives and as a community, as you build a country and a government, you would not put in the separation of powers that we have in our Constitution. The power being separated from the federal and the state, and then three branches of government. It's all part of understanding God's design for humanity. If you believe that men are basically good, you just find a really good person and put them in charge. But we know that power corrupts because we have a biblical worldview, as our founders did. And that's why we have the system of government that we do. Our founding fathers cited Scripture more than any other political or economic writers or texts. And they were trying as much as is humanly possible, given our flawed and sinful nature, to build a government that was oriented around biblical truth. And they recognized the only way to protect people from an abusive government was not to allow any one person or group of people to amass too much power. And even today, we've seen the value of the separation of powers. Rather than one of the things the founders feared was rule by the mob of the moment. And that's why they created all of these checks and balances that we learned about when we were in school. I'm not sure they're learning about them anymore. And for a quarter of a millennium, these biblical foundations, these ideas have held us together as a people. And so the United States of America, with all of its flaws and failings, because of these biblical principles present at its founding and the virtue of its many God-fearing people, praying people through the years, has been the most humane, selfless, peaceful, prosperous, welcoming, and just nation in the history of the world. That's just objectively true. We don't want to talk about that anymore. Not perfect. We've certainly been let down often by the failure of sinful people to live up to our core principles and values, enabling corruption and the deprivation of liberty, and many injustices, including most obviously the evil of slavery. And we fought a war to end slavery and to amend the Constitution so that we could live out our principles by granting equal rights to people regardless of race or sex. But the foundational and core biblical principles contained in the Declaration and in the Constitution, they're based on scriptural truth. The value of every life, every person has value. The freedom to pursue God, to worship God as you desire. The ownership of private property. People say, well, how does that fit in? Well, it's the Bible that teaches us, thou shalt not steal. That makes no sense in a Marxist economy where the government owns everything. Those principles were present at the founding. Our freedom of speech and of religion, equal justice, equal treatment under the law, these are all biblical principles that our founding fathers understood were true from God and were necessary for people to flourish and to live out God's purposes here on earth. So we read in the book of Proverbs that when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. And when a wicked man rules, the people groan. And that has application across our culture. So when people, godly people, virtuous people with a heart of service are in positions of authority, whether it's government or business or media or Hollywood, it's better for everybody. The people can flourish when godly people are in authority. And we've really moved away from that in our nation. So we have this beautiful foundation in biblical truth. We're constantly trying to hold ourselves accountable to these principles and to get better. And we've used our freedom of religion that we have in this nation, that many nations, as you know, do not have, in order to launch missions and missional efforts, are able to flourish out of this country because of the freedoms that we have. And yet, what have we done with this legacy? What went wrong? And if we're honest, we have been on a 60-year losing streak when it comes to the influence of Christianity in America, virtually my entire lifetime. When we brought George Barna to ACU, George has spent four decades gauging the biblical worldview of Americans, the faith of Americans, and the effect that it's having on our culture. So we now have real actual data that frankly backs up what we all sense, what we all see happening in our culture. And I feel bad for George. Sometimes I get to follow him to the podium at events where we're speaking, and I always have to warn people to stay away from sharp objects and high balconies after he's done, because the news is so hard to take. But the concept of biblical worldview is frankly comes from the Great Commission. So when Jesus told us as his followers to go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, it's the process of thinking and living like Jesus, according to his teachings and the commandments of Scripture. And so over the last 25 years, we have gone from 12% of Americans who were living their lives according to a biblical worldview to 4%. Just a third of what it was 25 years ago. So when you see what's happening in our culture, you're not imagining it. There really has been a decline of the influence of God-fearing Christian people in our country. There's a rise of what George refers to as the don'ts. They don't believe in God, they don't know, or they don't care if there's a God. Millennials are now our largest demographic in our country. And fully 43% of the millennial generation, almost half of millennials, fall into the don't category. Don't care, don't believe, don't know if there's a God. Even more concerning is that raising children, you think about Deuteronomy 6, you think about the desire, the need to pour biblical truth into our children, and only 2% of parents with children under 13 have a biblical worldview. And as George likes to say, you can't give what you don't have. And so we look, and with each generation, the level of commitment to Christ and biblical worldview is declining. We tell our students that their age, 18 to 20-year-olds, only 1% have a biblical worldview. So as they go out into this lost, hopeless world, they know that 99 of 100 people of their peers are not living and thinking according to the things of Christ. So all these things that are happening now in our culture are manifestations of this retreat from God. The rise of mental health issues, the incivility that I talked about, the volatility and conflict in our public discourse and politics, the violence, the addiction on our streets, and the more recent attacks on religious freedom and Bible-believing Christians in particular, they're all symptoms of a larger problem, which is that we are living now in a time similar to that described in the book of Judges, when there arose a generation that knew not God. That's what we're looking at today. That's the landscape. So we're seeing marriage and family redefined. We're seeing corruption at the highest levels of government and media, and in some places even the church. And yet, the fields are white unto harvest. I mean, what an opportunity that God chose us to live at this moment in history, that he chose us to have the resources, the freedom, the ability to speak into the future and to be difference makers for the future. Because you see, one of the things that is most concerning to me as I travel the country and talk to Christian leaders is that so many are discouraged by what's happened. It's easy to understand why. I mean, like I said, my whole lifetime, it's gotten worse. It's not gotten better. You have little outbreaks of good things, but if you look at the data, it has gotten worse. And so we've got to remember that a prime strategy of the enemy is to wear us out, wear us down, discourage us, make us focus on the waves and the storms instead of looking at Jesus. But God chose us to live now, and I want to encourage us, despite all of these challenges, there's an incredible opportunity for the gospel right now. Not only can we not give up, we need to understand that we really are only one generation away from living in a completely different world. One generation away from reclaiming our biblical foundations. How do we do that? How do we have hope for the future and a restoration of what has been stolen from this generation and give future generations the opportunity to flourish? And I've got to tell you, as somebody who spent a lot of time in the political arena, we've got to be thinking longer term than the next election. And I understand when you're running for office, the desire to say, hey, this is the most important election ever, and if we don't win this, it's the end of the world. I've been hearing that for 30 years. The elections matter. Don't get me wrong on this. We've got to be concerned about what's happening in government, for sure. But Sometimes that focus causes us to not make decisions that will lead to long-term generational change, because we forget for a moment that Jesus is still on the throne. God's not dead. In fact, he's not even tired yet. And politics, ultimately, and elections are downstream from culture. So what happens in our culture is going to affect future elections. So if you think about the opportunities for the gospel, the opportunities for revival, for awakening, there is an incredible opportunity that will affect everything in our culture, including the political circumstances. The call of God on our lives causes us to remember that despair is not an option. And, you know, I think some of us, it's easy to say, well, we're just seeing it's just going to keep getting worse, and Jesus is going to come back. He's got to come back, right? He's got to come back now. We don't know. Jesus doesn't know. He told us he doesn't even know the day or the hour. What we do know is that in 2,000 years of Christian history, beginning with the apostles, everybody thought they were living in the end times. I mean, just read it. They did, and they were closer to Jesus than we are. They were all wrong. And maybe we are too. Maybe we shouldn't have that mindset. Maybe we ought to be concerned about what type of a world we're going to leave to our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, rather than just giving up the culture. Nowhere in Scripture are we told to cower in the corner and beg for Jesus to come rescue us from a hostile culture. We're told to live in it, to be courageous, to be salt and light, and to stand as lights in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. Jesus taught us to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's a pretty clear call to engage, to try as much as possible to live out the kingdom of God on earth as we someday will in heaven. And that calling does not go away when times get tough. We also know from history and from Scripture that God can turn nations around. And it's interesting to me that it always starts with us. It starts with the body of Christ. If my people will humble themselves and pray. And so you look at the history of Israel, the nation of Israel. If you just read through it, you see a nation that turns away from God, and then things get hard and they turn back over and over again. And even in more recent history, in my book, Transforming Culture with Truth, I tell the story of what happened in Great Britain. And at the beginning of the 18th century in Great Britain, that nation was more pagan, more godless, more immoral than we are in America today. And God brought a revival and awakening that not only led to things in Great Britain, the reformation of morals, the abolition of slavery, but it also led to the awakening that poured through the American colonies. That's one of the reasons we've lived for the last 2.5 centuries in the freedom that we've had, is because of what God did then. But it would have been really easy sitting in Great Britain at that season of life to say, if God doesn't judge this, you know, he's going to have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah, you know, and say, well, we give up. They didn't do that. And God sent an awakening. So there's no reason that can't happen again. And I think the opportunity is prime right now. So we need to have hope for the future. We have to think about and invest in the future. Now, that's easy for Tracy and me. As Pastor shared, we had 8 children, and now we have 18 grandchildren, and that's them at Thanksgiving. And the oldest is 7. And it's two things. It's a visual to make my final point about the importance of children and the next generation. And it's also a shameless way to show you a picture of our grandkids. We have to focus on young people and on children. George Barna's latest bestseller, published by Arizona Christian University Press just a few months ago, is called Raising Spiritual Champions. And it calls us in the body of Christ to recognize what are the things that we need to do to get a biblical worldview to stick with young people so that they will carry it throughout their lives. And we kind of need an all-hands-on-deck moment where we focus on teaching biblical principles to our children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren in the home, in our churches, and in Christian schools. So let me give you real quick 3 things that we all can do in this season. Number one, start with your own family and those that you have influence with, your friends and others, and encourage them to keep pouring biblical truth into young people. the influence of grandparents on their grandchildren is so much greater than I think we have ever recognized. And just remember that young children are sponges. They're looking for something to hang on to, something true, something authentic. And there's just an opportunity, you know, not only to encourage your kids and your grandkids in the faith, but to really speak directly to generations that are younger than ours. Teach them those spiritual lessons that will enable them, that will give them a foundation to hang on to as they grow older. Second, get involved in building institutions that will outlast and outlive us. Invest time and resources in institutions dedicated to biblical training, the training of children and young adults. So get behind a local Christian K-12 school, volunteer if you're able, and support Christian schools and universities that are sticking to biblical truth, that are preparing young Christians to be leaders. You know, I have the opportunity in my role to talk to people about their finances and ask them to consider being generous with what God has given them. And all that is a reflection of the biblical worldview. That's an understanding that nothing that we have here goes with us into a place that's going to have more riches than we can even imagine. But what does matter now is what we do that will have eternal significance. And so I frequently have the opportunity to sit in front of people and just remind them of that truth, and that there's an opportunity right now to do things that will have significance for generations yet unborn. And the third thing, and this is a larger cultural issue that we face in our nation, you know, I made some jokes about the size of our family, but the reality is the problem in the world is no longer an overpopulation crisis. It's an underpopulation crisis. We have lost so much hope in the future that young people are choosing not to get married and not to have children. And for a lot of folks who have a worldview that says that climate change is going to end the earth, there's too many people, I can understand why they don't want to have families. But for Christians, for followers of Christ, you know, we have to recall that the very first words that were spoken to mankind were to be fruitful and multiply, to fill the earth and govern it. And that's never been revoked. If you look at how Jesus dealt with children and you look at what Scripture says about children, they're always a blessing. They're not a burden. God promises that He will provide for us, both emotionally, physically, financially. But we need young people today need to hear that message, even in the church. They need to hear it from us. The younger generation needs to hear the significance of being open to having children and allowing God to bless them in that way. You know, we were blessed when we were young because we met a lot of people who regretted either not having kids or not having more kids. And so we could take that into account while we were young. But young people today are not hearing that. I never met people that said they regretted having children. That just wasn't a common refrain. So that's an important thing that we need to start speaking as the body of Christ again to younger people and encourage them and help them. It's not easy, especially today. It's not easy to raise children. So if you've got family members that are having children, consider what you can do to support them and encourage them in that. And think about how different our country could look in just one or two generations if Christian young people who follow God took seriously that guidance from God, guidance from Scripture. So these are the things that I think can make a difference for the next generation. When our family was young and we had eight young kids at home, I was in a softball league. It was a lawyers' league. Feel bad for the umpires. You can do that. That was a real thing. But I got into a debate one time with one of the guys on the team who was also an attorney, and we went back and forth for 30 minutes on the issue of abortion, and I didn't budge him, and he didn't budge me. And finally, I said, "You know, how many kids do you have?" And he said, "My wife and I have one," and she says, "That's it." And I said, "Well, we've got eight kids, and someday my kids are going to outvote yours." And so that also applies with grandchildren. And so we just have to have a mindset of building things that are going to outlast us, churches, schools, universities, and families dedicated to countering the current secular cultural narratives. We literally are just one generation away from a complete spiritual turnaround. In one generation, our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren could be living in a culture again where Christ is at the center and people are flourishing. I love this verse. The Apostle Paul writes in the first chapter of Colossians, "For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together." In him all things hold together. So even though right now all the news is bad all the time, that's our current reality. It's because we have removed from the center of our culture the one thing, the one person in whom all things hold together. We need to restore Christ to the center of our lives and our community and our nation. So what an opportunity we have in this moment to bring the gospel to young people, to bring the gospel to the world. At a moment when the world seems to be unraveling, there is such desperation and hopelessness. People are looking for what is authentic and true, and that's Jesus. And we have answers. We have the hope, we have the love, we have the grace to share with people around us. We can bring hope for restoration, for rebuilding, and for awakening through him in whom all things hold together. So take to heart these words from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 58, verse 12. And these are words that I share with each class of graduates of Arizona Christian University, the numbers of which are growing every year. "That those from among you will rebuild the ancient ruins, raise up the age-old foundations. You will be called repairers of the breach, restorers of the streets in which we dwell." What an opportunity we have to see the greatest awakening ever. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, we thank you this morning for the promises of your word, which remind us to not despair at our circumstances, but to be hopeful based on the power that you have to transform lives through the preaching of your word, through the reading of scripture, and through changing hearts and lives. Lord, we recognize that things have been challenging in our country. So God, we do pray that in your mercy, you would draw us back to you. Father, that you would enable us to return to you without huge judgment and pain. Lord, we know it's your kindness that leads to repentance. And so, God, we ask that in your mercy, you would draw us as a nation, as a people, to repentance and a restoration of the foundations that were built on your truth. God, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.